think prayer matters. Last week in part one, I shared with you this idea that our private place of prayer really, really matters. I basically unpacked the idea that what nobody sees will impact what everybody around you experiences. And that has been something that I've been wrestling with all week long in my private, going, oh my gosh, Lord, you just checked me here to make sure my private life is right so my public life can demonstrate your love, grace, and power to others. And so if we delve about that, and today what I want to jump into is I want to jump into what? Everybody say what? Well, here's what you jump into. I want you to jump into what you pray for matters. I really want to share this with you. I think that there are so many things that are correct for us as followers of Jesus Christ to pray for. There's so many things. I think it was funny to watch a little list of different food things that maybe I've mentioned apparently in the last year. I really think that was last 15. I really don't think I did that all in 1 year. And so I'm really sorry for making you so hungry. But there's so many things that we can list that are correct and accurate to pray for. So many different things. And so today I'm just going to share a couple of things. And again, we're going to do this. We're going to look at the prayers that Jesus prayed. Because if there's ever someone who knew how to pray, it was Jesus. Amen? And he shows us how to pray. And we're going to look at Jesus for a simple reason. Because what we pray for matters. And so there's at least, I want to create a look like a cell. I want to take a look at two prayers of Jesus today. And I believe that if you all have ears to hear what the Spirit of God is saying, I believe there's three or four tremendous truths that we need to hear, that we need to receive. We need to take these things home. We need to put them in a to-go bag and say, well, impact this all week long and begin to live this out more and more and more and experience these truths in our lives. And so with that, before I talk about prayer more, we should pray. So how about we just do that? Heavenly Father, I pray right now, you just give me a settled feeling. Lord, for anybody here today who's struggling with a settled feeling, just give them a settled feeling right now. I pray that the peace of God that surpasses all understanding would permeate their hearts and minds. I pray that you remove every distraction. I pray that you would help us to focus in on what you want to share with us for this little bit of time that we have together today. And Lord, I know that what we pray about really, really matters. And so, Lord, help us to pray like you do. I pray you would minister to us, God, because we really need you today, right now. We need you. There are some people in this room and online that are facing things that are just so challenging and so difficult. God, they need you. And I pray for them that you would just lift them up and strengthen them right now. In Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen, amen, amen. I want to begin with a story. It's a true story. This is a true story about a lady named Eva Moses Kaur. She's a Holocaust survivor who forgave her Nazi captors. Kaur and her twin sister Miriam were among the children experimented on by the infamous Dr. Joseph Mengele at the Auschwitz concentration camp during World War II. In 1995, Kaur returned to Auschwitz with a group of Holocaust survivors who made a public statement of forgiveness towards the Nazis. She stated that forgiveness did not mean forgetting or excusing what happened, but rather that it was her way to let go of the anger and the pain that had consumed her for so many years. Kaur's act of kindness and forgiveness was controversial with some Holocaust survivors and their families, feeling that forgiveness was impossible given the atrocities committed by the Nazis. However, Kaur remains steadfast in her belief that forgiveness was a powerful tool for healing and reconciliation. Kaur went on to establish the Candle, which is an acronym, Holocaust Museum and Education Center in Indiana, which is dedicated to educating the public about the Holocaust and promoting forgiveness and healing. She passed away in 2019 at the age of 85, but her legacy of forgiveness and compassion lives on as an inspiring story to so many. Isn't that just an absolutely incredible story? Experiment it on as a child. You can Google it and find out more. But to get to that place, to say, we're going to go to the place where this happened, and we're going to just declare publicly that we're granting forgiveness, we're giving forgiveness. And, And I want you to understand what she said there. Forgiveness did not mean forgetting or excusing. It was her way to let go. I'm going to say let go. It was her way to let go of the anger and the pain that it consumed her for so, what she described, for so many years. So the first tremendous truth that I want to share today is this. And I would write this down. The prayer of forgiveness is perhaps the most important prayer of our lifetime. The most important, when it comes to what should we pray for, we should pray for forgiveness. I put a little video out earlier this week, and I said, hey, how many of you feel stuck, and you just can't move forward? You're stuck in the past, you're stuck in the present, but you really can't. You feel stuck. One of the most underlying reasons that people are stuck in life is because they are stuck with bitterness. When you are root-bound with the root of bitterness, it is because the seed of unforgiveness has germinated in your life and taken hold, and then bitterness produces all kinds of weird fruit. And I know exactly what I'm talking about because from the age of 12 until about the age of 24, I had unforgiveness in my life towards someone who had done something very wrong to me. And I didn't want to forgive them, I didn't want to talk to them, I didn't want anything to do with them. And then finally, I said, I wrote a letter, I said, I forgive you. I'm not forgetting what you did. I'm not excusing what you did. I don't agree with what you did. And we don't have to be friends. But I forgive you. Do you know everything began to change in my life after that point? I mean, radically changed. I mean, accelerated all kinds of stuff. But I was stuck. And so some people today, you are stuck. And you don't know why. And if you're not sure, how do I know if I really need to pray this prayer of forgiveness? Because you still enjoy telling stories. It should be under the blood. As a pastor, I get exhausted about hearing the stories of the past that should be under the blood. What are you talking about? I don't need to talk about that right now. I just tell you, as a pastor, I hear it, and I'm like, wow, that's what I care about. I'm so sorry. And I want to just tell you more. I'm saying just forgive the past and move on. Because those things that I had a hard time letting go of that hurt me, that almost controlled me for a while, I don't have conversations about these things anymore. You know why? Because I took them in the spirit of blessedness with the blood of Christ. I said, I forgive you, Jesus forgives you, I'm moving on and I'm moving forward. But I am not reliving that. I will learn from that, but I will not. I'm not going to relive it. Does that make sense? And so today, I want you to understand that perhaps the most important what should we pray for? What we pray for matters. Forgiveness. Forgiveness really matters. The story that I read is great. Isn't that a great story of forgiveness? But there is no story of forgiveness that is greater than the story of Jesus Christ and His forgiveness. The agony of the cross, the pain of the cross, the suffering of the cross, the shame of the cross, the mocking that He experienced at the cross, the misery of the cross, the torment of the cross. Jesus Christ deserves absolutely none of what He experienced at the cross. Yet, He prayed an absolutely amazing prayer. I find it interesting that three of the four gospel writers only capture one part of the prayer. And I think it's John that captures the whole bunch of other stuff where he prays his disciples and prays for God to be glorified. He didn't really pray for himself at all. It's really, and so if we put it all together, it's a really unself-focused prayer. But at one moment, He does pray something. And I want you to take a look at this. I'm sorry. No, I'm getting my points confused. Everything I just said was true, but it's about another point in the sermon. It's about the second prayer, Andy. Anyways, so let me fast forward here. I'm going to talk to you about the prayer that Jesus prayed in the garden. Three out of four gospel writers put one little snippet about that. One gospel writer wrote a whole lot more about what he prayed about. Yeah, okay. Now let's get back to this extraordinary prayer where Christ is on the cross. It's in Luke 23, verse 34. Look at this. And Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Was that not extraordinary prayer? I want you to think of that. We just celebrated Easter, didn't we? So this should be fresh in our mind. We had a Good Friday service where we really thought and reflected upon everything that Christ went through at the cross and how unfair it was, how unjust it was, and how He freed us from sin by going there. And in this place on the cross, he prays out this incredible prayer, God, forgive them. Father, please forgive them. They don't really know what they're doing, Father. It's such an extraordinary example of praying the prayer of forgiveness. Now, I want you to observe something that is going to bother you. It's this. Sometimes when you pray like Jesus did, it doesn't always change those who sinned against you. I wish it would, but it doesn't always, and it didn't happen for Jesus. If we take a look at the verses that follows, it reports that those he prayed for continued to mock him, then they divided his garments, and then they told him, go ahead and save yourself. So his prayer of forgiveness didn't change their behavior. So what happened? Well, what happens is, when we pray this kind of prayer, though it may not change those who have wronged us, it will liberate us from the wrongs that they've done against us. You see, some of you right now, you're living in the prison of the past because you endure and embrace and coddle the pain of the sin that was done against you. You play with it, you relive it, you rekindle it, you toy with it, you memorialize it, you pet it, you re-experience it. You allow it to control your thoughts. You allow it to control your conversations. You allow it to control your money. You allow it to control your marriage. You allow it to control so many things in your life. You allow it not because of it. You say, I'm not having any friends. You do all kinds of things that limit you and put you in a prison of that past hurt that you experienced. And what the prayer of forgiveness does is it liberates you at that moment to say, you no longer have control over me. Though you hurt me deeply, though you wounded me profoundly, that is not going to stop me from living my life today. And some of you right now, you're like, man, I really don't know what you're talking about. And others of you, you have been hurt deeply. And right now, what I'm telling you is challenging you. That's good. That means your gears are turning, your thinking. Because those of you that have been hurt deeply, sinned against tremendously, wounded at the core of who you are to the point where it almost just reshapes you as a person. I want you to listen to what Jesus said. Father, forgive them. I want you to hear what Jesus said. I forgive you. Because I'm not going to allow the pain of the past to control me anymore. And when you get liberated by giving that forgiveness out and saying, God, I forgive them. And you just, how long do you pray this prayer? You pray this prayer until it doesn't hurt. I can look back in my rearview mirror of life, and I can mentally visit ages 12 to 24 when I had that unforgiveness in my heart. And I can think back from ages 9 to 12 where the tremendous hurt occurred in my life. Here to tell you, it doesn't hurt anymore. It doesn't control my relationships anymore. It doesn't control my faith anymore or my faithlessness anymore. It doesn't control me. It doesn't control me. If I were to roll up my pants right now on my left leg, you would see a scar that goes from right here to right here. As well as the feet, they did casts and braces, and this one didn't taste very good. They did a surgery. There's a scar there. A scar doesn't hurt. Every once in a while, it's just that I've never hurt. My pants doesn't hurt. But I look at it, and it's a sign that something happened. And it's a greater sign that something tremendous has happened. That's called healing. And so you'll know that the prayer of forgiveness that doesn't work in you, when you can look back in life and know you don't forget it, and know you don't excuse it, but now you know that a healing took place. It might itch every once in a while, but it is not going to control you, trip you up, or if you want to use a word today, a lot of people seem to be using it, it's not going to trigger you. Because forgiveness will do its work. Amen? If everything triggers you, you might need to release the forgiveness. Amen? Are you with me, church? I spent a little bit more time there than I intended to, but I just felt like I needed to share that with you so you would just get that in your spirit. So, if forgiveness allows you to move, check it out, allows you to move beyond your past. If we think about Eva, her past became anger and pain. If we think about the Apostle Peter,
his past included tremendous regret. He had a tremendous regret that he denied knowing Jesus Christ, not once, not twice, but three times. That was holding him in the past. But in John 21, Jesus restored Peter, and it is a beautiful picture of how the Lord helps us to move beyond the mistakes of our past. Because sometimes it's the forgiveness, the prayer of forgiveness that we need to pray is for ourselves. God, forgive me. Forgive me for sinning. Forgive me for hurting. Forgive me for using the knife. Forgive me for doing whatever it was. And so that prayer of forgiveness, when we pray that over someone or over ourselves, I love how Jesus gets back with Peter and is like, hey, do you love me? Yeah, do you love me? Yeah, do you love me? Feed my sheep, tend my sheep, serve my sheep. What did Jesus do in that moment? He said, Peter, I forgive you. I'm restoring you. You're moving forward. You're not going to be stuck in the shadows of the doubts and despair of the past. But now, you are going to be used to launch a New Testament church. You are going to change the world. Your past isn't going to hold you back because of the God that forgives. We need to experience the God that forgives in our lives, and we need to go and forgive others. Amen? I'll tell you what, it is one of the greatest prayers that we could ever do. So if you're ready to move beyond your past, to no longer allow the hurts and the wrongs done to you to have any control over you in your present or in your future, pray whatever you need to pray for in the area of forgiveness. You just begin to pray. You say, God, I'm going to pray this. And this is an important prayer because Matthew 6 and 15 tells us that we cannot be forgiven until we forgive others. So that pretty much means any other prayers that we pray, what we pray for matters. No matter what we pray for doesn't matter if we have unforgiveness in our hearts. Did you hear what I just said? No matter what you pray for, it doesn't matter if you have unforgiveness in your heart. So anything that I prayed for from age 12 to 24 really didn't matter. God got the prayer. So I believe in my mind it went over here and sat on a shelf. Because what I didn't understand with that unforgiveness was I had clogged the grapevine between me and heaven with my unforgiveness. And so I said, Lord, I forgive, and as soon as I did that, wow, it was like liquid Drano. Remember when you use Drano? Don't you just thank God that stuff works? Right? You know what I'm saying? It's like you use the phone here, it doesn't work. Can you use it? Thank you. And so I was just like, thank you, God. I just felt so this release on the inside at that moment. I'm telling you what, it was 12 years of mercy that was pent up, 12 years of grace that was pent up, 12 years of revelation that was pent up. It all came in like 30 days. It blew my mind. It absolutely revolutionized my life. And I'm here to tell you, God can do more with you in the next week, in the next 30 days, than he's able to do in the last decade if you will just pray the prayer of forgiveness and let go of some junk in Jesus' name. Can anybody who's ever prayed like me just say, yeah, pastor is telling the truth. Listen to what he's saying and pray the prayer of forgiveness. Amen? Let's do it right now. Let's do it right now. Heavenly Father, I pray. Search my heart, God. If I am holding a grudge against anybody, if there are people that have sinned against me, God, then now I say I forgive them. And Lord, throughout the rest of the day, if you bring their name to my mind, I'm going to call out their name, and I'm going to say their name and say, Jesus, I forgive them. And I'm going to mean it, and I'm going to pray it until they don't come to my mind anymore. And by the way, I see them differently. I see them as the broken person, the person that they are, the imperfect person that they are. We're all imperfect. So God, right now, we pray and we forgive those that have wronged us. We forgive those that have hurt us. We forgive those who have sinned against us. And then God, right now, I pray for myself. I'm not perfect. I might be the first one that somebody else has hurt. And so Lord, right now, I pray that you would forgive me, God, completely and thoroughly, through and through. In the strong name of Jesus, this is the most important prayer I can pray. I believe. I call upon you, my Lord, and Savior. I totally anticipate getting some messages about how this is freeing you and liberating you and helping you in Jesus' name. So then the next prayer of Jesus that I want to bring to our attention is when Jesus is at the bottom of the Mount of Olives. And I don't know where my pictures from my trip to Israel are, so maybe I'll have to go back and get more. I don't know. I've got to find them. I think they're on another computer, a portable hard drive. So I have to steal some off the internet. But I wanted to show you
some pictures for a second. Here we go. Awesome. Thank you for showing us. Take that picture right there and all these different pictures. The Mount of Olives, this is modern day. And if you were to go to Israel today, what you would notice is right here, you see all this? You say, what is that? It's a massive graveyard. And so as you go, and really the Mount of Olives, it's called a mountain, but it used to be called a hill. Because it's really not that tall. You can easily walk to the top or the bottom, really easy. Even as a state, you can do it. Okay, no rock climbing experience or anything like that. You can totally do this. And so, oh, that picture got cut off. That's not cool. Oh, that's not a picture. That's fine. That's cool. So, anyway, this shows where people, and what happened was, people would be buried in a tomb, right? That's when Jesus was buried in a borrowed tomb. Why was it a borrowed tomb? That was a Jewish custom. They stayed there for 1 year. There was a hole that would let air ventilate, and they'd go back a year after they buried the person in the tomb, and they would gather their bones, and they would bring them to a family casket and put their bones in there. I'm sorry, kid. I just stick with me. So this is what one side of Mount Olives looks like. But as you turn to your right and begin to look down, you see this wooded area. And right here, you see this building. And then next to it, this is what is believed to be the Garden of Gethsemane. And I've been there. And what's amazing is there's a tree there. I wish I could find a stupid picture. But the tree trunk is massive. I mean, it's like, how many things are big enough on stage? You can get your arms even around a third of that thing. And people are like, you know, this tree is so old that this might have been like a sapling when Jesus was in the garden praying before he went to the cross. Wow, that's incredible. And so, what's interesting, this is the Mount of Olives, and right here, where he was praying, a poor guy, a wonderful Jewish man named Ronnie, was like, you know, the reason he was praying down here is kind of interesting. He said that they would harvest all these olives, but it's at the foot of the hill in the Kidron Valley, right here. And then if you go back up the hill in the opposite direction, you come to Jerusalem. And you would see the Golden Gate. You would see the splendor of God's temple. Okay. So he said, what they do right here is this is the place of pressing. This is where they press all the olives. So that it makes order. How many of you have ever pressed something hard? Really hard. Remember the juice in those old juice commercials? Remember that dude? Some dude, juice everything. Right? It took a lot of energy to juice, and so this is a place of pressing. This is where Jesus was before he went to the cross. This is the place of pressing. Prayed an absolutely amazing prayer. I'm going to read this to you from Luke's Gospel. We're going to stop, I think, around 42, we're going to stop. But check this out, verse 39. He came out and went, and as was his custom, to the Mount of Olives, and to the disciple, and the disciple followed him. And when he came to the place, he said to them, pray that you may not enter into temptation. And I underline this. Here's Jesus doing it. And apparently a place that he's in the heaven of glory. He likes to go to this place of pressing, this garden, this beautiful area. He likes to go and pray, but get exactly to this place. And he knelt down and he prayed, saying this, Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. And my pastor, what does that have to do with what we should pray for? Well, here's what I want you to write down. When you are hard-pressed, we need to pray that we will stay aligned with God's will. Did you hear me? When you are hard-pressed, the best prayer that you can pray is, God, help me to stay on track for you. Help me not to get derailed. Help me, Lord, to be obedient to the things that you have called me to do. You say, Pastor, why is this so important? Well, I want to share a couple of spiritual truths with you. This is how God's big picture for your life happens.
God's big picture for your life happens through His will. Did you hear me? His big picture plan. Now, how many of God has a big picture plan for each and every one of you? Amen? And it happens as we execute and live out His will for our lives. The big picture for the life of Christ was the cross. The cross was the big picture. The cross and the resurrection and the ascension of Christ. That was the big picture for Christ. That was that He needed to pray. God, if you can get me out of this, cool. But nevertheless, not my will, Your will be done. And it's so important that we be willing to pray that kind of prayer. God, I really don't like what's on the calendar this week, but let Your will be done. If there's any way You can get me out of this or that, cool. But if not, I'm going to stand up tall. I'm going to pray. I'm going to walk with the confidence that the God who created me and the God who gave me the gift to live this life. And I'm going to go do my best to pray Him this week. And Jesus said, help me, Lord, to stay alive with Your will no matter what I am facing. I want you to think of Joseph in the Old Testament. I'm sure that he prayed a lot to stay true to his beliefs, to stay true to his values, didn't he? He must have. He had to have. Yet he was hard-pressed. Thrown in a pit, thrown in a prison, forgotten about it. Not being hard-pressed. Falsely accused of hard-pressed. Yet what was God's big picture for him? Oh, that he would save an entire nation from a famine. And by the way, reunite a dysfunctional family. It was dysfunctional. Yeah, they told about a dream and they sold the slavery. That's really dysfunctional. That's not healthy. But the big picture was I'm going to use you. And you're going to save all kinds of people in your family. And we'll reunite you with your family. That's the big picture. By the way, my Savior family, that's the nation. Through you, that's the big picture. So, how many times do you say the temptation ran across his mind to say, Paul, God's will. I'm just going to do it. I'm getting accused anyway. Right? I'm going to become like them. But no, he did not. He stayed true to who he was. He continued to pray. He continued to be faithful. And God's big picture began to develop right before his eyes in a way that he couldn't figure out. He didn't know when he was in the pit what God's big picture was. He didn't know when he was in the palace what God's big picture was. He didn't know probably until all of a sudden everything began to matter. Oh my goodness gracious. Now I am seeing what is going on. So often life, we make our mark in life and we don't even know what we're making our mark. We got to look back to what there it was. Didn't even know that I was doing that at the time. I want you to think of the Apostle Paul in the New Testament. He was hard-pressed so many times. Come on! Have you read about the suffering of Paul? If there was anybody that ever felt like their head was in a vice or their life was, he had to feel that pressing, that hard-pressing. Yet God's big picture was to use him. Growing 2/3 of the New Testament to be a founding father of the New Testament church and to set things in order and give correction where needed to be a tremendous, extraordinary leader that we still quote to God. The big picture for him was absolutely incredible. And the reality is, a lot of people here today, you may not know God's big picture. You may not know what it is yet. Or maybe you do. But either way, I want to ask you this. What is your pressing point? Where is the place of pressing in your life? For Jesus, it was the Garden of Gethsemane at the foot of the Mount of Olives, right there at the foot. Bam. That was the place of pressing that we came together. He could see, he could look up and see the holy city of God. As he looked up to the temple, he knew that beyond that is the hill, the place of the stone of God, that he knew what was coming. He could see with supernatural vision. So I just want to ask you, are you hard pressed right now? And if you are, where is your place of pressing? And if you identify with this, here's what I want to pray for you for relief today. I want to pray for you that you hang on to God. And you'll say, God, help me to stay aligned with your will. Help me not to compromise an inch. In Jesus' name. Help me. I think of the movie Spider-Man. No, Captain America. How do you see Captain America? And when he was, before he became Captain America, he got beat up one time. And he
stood back up, and the bully said, "How much more can you take?" You know, his response is, "I could do this all day." Right? And as the movie goes later, as he gets, you know, turns into somewhat even, you know, more dynamic in the movie. I bring that to your attention because I think that what we need to do is we need to pray that kind of prayer. We need to pray, "God, here I am. And I can do this all day long. I can do it. I can do it. I can do it." Why? Because greater is He that is in me than He that is in the world. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. Though I am pressed and hard, the Bible says, perplexed and hard pressed every time, yeah, I feel like a person. God is doing something day by day on the inside of me. And so it's just a matter at some point of having some resolve and just some stubbornness. Come in here, stubborn. I could be so stubborn. I could be stupid stubborn. I mean, just, I can't tell you the times I've been stupid stubborn with Jennifer in a conversation. She said, "Go home." I'm like, "Okay, I'm done doing dumb things. I apologize. I'm just forgive me. It's time to get to the gap. I'm hard to comprehend. But it happened. Excuse me." And so, but I want to use that stubbornness for good. Said, "No, God, I'm going to keep on pressing." And when you do that, you stay true to God's will. You stay aligned to God's will. I tell you, it's the greatest prayer that you can pray. I've been through some hard weeks with Pastor. Last week was really hard. I talked about last Sunday. I won't relive it, but getting up last Sunday was not an easy thing to do. So many emotional things that we have dealt with, and minister people, and walk with people through, and even this week, we're going to do some more walking. And, but in those times, it's like, "God, there's something on the inside of me. I'm going to stick with God's will. Because if I stick with God's will, I know this next thing is true." And this is why we should pray that we stay in alignment with God's will. Not only for the big picture for your life habits, but also this kind of prayer and resolve is so vital, because this kind of prayer releases supernatural sources of strength in our life. I'm telling you what, it absolutely does. I want you to look at Jesus and what he experienced while he was praying. This is before his prayer is even done. In verse 30, in Luke 22, verse 43 to 44, it says this: "And there appeared to him an angel from heaven, strengthening him. And then in agony, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat became like great drops of blood falling down to the ground." Wow. That's stress. I think that fits the description of being stressed to the max. But in the midst of praying, "Lord, not my will, but thy will be done," in the midst of a prayer that says, "God, help me to stay aligned with your will," supernatural strength came in the form of an angel. An angel showed up and strengthened him. Maybe you don't get how an angel strengthens him, but that would be kind of like a homecoming gift. Have you ever been away from home and then you get a care package from home? Come on, we send our boys care packages from home every once in a while when they go to school. How many of you received a care package when you were away? How many of you have been away somewhere? Somebody said, "It's nice, right? This is a care package." Why? Because the native place for Jesus is heaven. It's glory. It's the throne of God. You understand, in the beginning was the Word was God, the Word was with God. Amen. You understand that He always was and always will be. And so a kind of a little gift from home came to him. An angel came and ministered to him, strengthened him. What an awesome thing. But it happened for Jesus as he prayed. And as he prays, I know we need to pray. As he prays, "God, help me to stay aligned with your will." How much more do we need to pray, "God, help me to stay aligned with your will"? But when you do that and have that resolve, God says, "Now I'm going to give you supernatural strength." It was a stressful thing. And I want you to understand that what Jesus prayed for and what he was praying for to stay aligned with his will, he got the supernatural strength. But I want you to hear something. In all of his prayers, the circumstances didn't change. So what do you do when Golgotha is still there? What do you do when the giant is still mocking King's son? What do you do when they still throw you in with the lions? What do you do when they turn up the furnace 7 times hotter. And though you prayed, your circumstances do not change. You know what did change, though the circumstances didn't change? Something indescribable on the inside of Jesus changed. And when we pray to stay aligned with God's will, and when we get supernaturally strengthened, something on the inside of us changes by the power and the glory of God that is indescribable. It is a mystery of God, but it is something on the inside that is absolutely amazing, that strengthens us, that helps us to pick up our feet and to keep moving forward one more time and one more time after that and one more time after that and one more time after that and one more time after that. And when we do, that's when we find out that there is resurrection power in the God that we pray to. Though they might kill you, you'll rise up again. Though they might throw you in the lion's den, you'll just use them as a comforter and a pillow. Though they throw you into a barbecue, you won't even come out smelling like smoke. This is the God that we serve. The circumstances might not change, but He will give you supernatural strength on the inside that is just absolutely indescribable. How many of you can testify of, Pastor, I prayed one time and the circumstances didn't change, but something changed on the inside of me. And I walked through it, and I endured, and I overcame, and I conquered, even though all the odds were against me. And it's because God did something on the inside. Okay, well, we'd love to hear your story. I'd love to read your story, tell us sometime and share it. If you've got a story like that, tell us. Let us know your story. Write it down, email us, please. We want to hear your story. Because people need to understand that when we pray to stick to God's will, the supernatural strengthening still happens today. And He will see us through it. Are you with me, church? The Bible is full of people who prayed and experienced strengthening from the Lord as they stuck to God's will. I think of Daniel. I think of Elijah. I think of Paul. I don't have time to talk about all of them, but what will your experience look like as you pray? I'm not sure. But I do know what the prophet Isaiah said. He said He gives power to the faint, and to him who has no might, He increases strength. Even youth shall faint and be weary, and young men shall fall exhausted. But they who wait upon the Lord, come on, somebody. And I'm telling you, waiting prayer is a good way to wait before the Lord. Those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Wait for the Lord. What's the way to wait? Go ahead and pray. That's what Jesus is doing. He's waiting on the Lord. Waiting on the Lord. Supernatural strength, because if you need strength, we know what we are going to pray for today, don't we? We're going to pray that the supernatural strengthening of God become as you pray. God, help me to stay in alignment and agreement with you. Help me to build my life synchronized with your will. In Jesus' name, help me to live that out. Because as you do that, as you pray that prayer, as you mean that prayer, oh my goodness. God's big picture begins to develop in your life. God begins to open doors you never thought He'd open. And when God opens doors, you're going to face challenges. How do you know the promised land is good? How do you know the promised land is better than the wilderness? Right? They had one, they had a cafeteria that only had maybe 2 things, 12 maintenance. Right? Now they're going to go into a place that's so amazing, the harvest is so bountiful, it takes 2 people to carry the grape facility around the world. But it's a land that was overflowing with abundance. And God ushered them in. And that was the big picture for their life, but they still had to go and conquer. And so what I'm trying to say is there's always going to be things in life that you're going to have to conquer. You're going to face challenges. You're going to face trials. You're going to face tests. Sometimes God will part the waters. Sometimes God will make the walls fall down like He did at Jericho. Absolutely. But there's going to be times when you need to get that resolve that says, get building for me. I will thank you. I can do this all for you. Because there's something on you inside that says, get up! Get up! It's that same voice that spoke to Lazarus. Get up, Lazarus. Come forth. There is a come forth calling for those in Christ that pray to stay aligned with His will. That He just get it. I don't know. I'm doing this. I don't know how I'm doing this. We don't have to know. We just know that there's the Holy Ghost on the inside.
without that supernatural strength, you'll never see God's big picture fully developed in your life. You'll experience all kinds of little picture things. And that's why so many people are depressed today. That's why so many people take pills and do different things, because they're living a life far from God, or they're living a life with God, but don't rely on God. Did you catch that footnote? They're living for God, but they're not relying upon God. I know plenty of people that are Christians that I can't remember the last time anything in their life was part of faith. That they would be satisfied to live a life that's boring, that's mediocre, that doesn't give God any real story of glory. Did you hear this? And so, what that means is that in order for God to get some glory, it's going to be times like we're going to go, oh my gosh, this is kind of life. This experience right here is supposed to be enough. This right here is pulling me beyond what I can do. God, if you don't come through, I'm going to fall through. Right? You know what I'm saying? And it's not that we should pray for those things, but we should not back down. We should say, yes, God. Yes, to your will. Whatever it is, God, I am going to pursue this Jesus thing. Are you with me, church? I guess what I'm saying is, if you'll open your eyes, there are opportunities for God to do some supernatural, extraordinary things to your life. If you feel bored in your Christian walk, just pray like this: God, I'm only a little bit bored. So it's not like telling your mom that you're bored and you're here. Apparently in Jennifer's house, they knew, her and Jennifer Dale knew, don't say you're bored to mom. Because that just gives you something to clean. You can leave, you can clean. And so I would just tell God I'm a little bit bored. And then maybe he'll give you a little bit of something that will kind of like open your eyes up to life. But then allow you to say, God, not my will, but thy will be done. I'm going to press through that. I know you. I know what you've called me to. I know the gifts and talents that you've given me. I know I'm going to have to develop myself to climb that mountain to get right up that mountain. I know that you'll meet me there. I know that you'll help me get over this. I know that you'll give me the strength that I need. I'm going to be committed to you. And all, I'm telling you what, that's an extraordinary prayer to pray. And life will get very exciting for you as a Christian. And you begin to pray, God, I want you in alignment with your plan for my life. I'm telling you folks, what we pray for matters. If you believe it, give God your total attention. Can we stand this morning? I want to just conclude in prayer. I'm not sure how to navigate next, so I'll just ask the Lord to kind of lead us. Address the issue of feeling stuck and afraid of prayer and forgiveness, but I want to move over to something else, the sense of being overwhelmed. Sometimes life can be overwhelming. Sometimes being obedient to God and fulfilling His word can be overwhelming. I've had weeks like that before. Overwhelming. In those moments, Lord, I pray, I know I've got to do this. I can't ignore this. I can't delegate this. I've got to do this. And so if you're facing that kind of moment today, I want you to go from overwhelmed by what you're facing to overwhelmed in the one who you're praying to. And knowing that if God, if His will for Jesus was to go to a cross, Jesus trusted His Father that there was something greater than the cross on the other side. It says, despising the shame, went to the cross. But there was something greater than the cross. There was resurrection. Come on, somebody. There was redemption. There was justification. There was renewal with God. It's such a great thing. So as you are overwhelmed by what you're facing, as you remain diligent and obedient to God, and you say, God, I want to be aligned with your will, Lord, I want you to go from overwhelmed by that circumstance to overwhelmed by how God loves you. Loves you. And I want you to hold on to that thought as you face something that is really hard and overwhelming. I want you to hold on to God and say, God, I'm not going to leave you in this moment. So
so many people run from God. When they go and get stuff, they get running. I want you to run to God. I want you to cling to Him. I want you to be overwhelmed as you begin to worship God. And you begin to read the Bible. I want God to begin to fill you with your mind of how great our God is. How great the potential is to go. This is extraordinary. I want you to think about this. When those Hebrew boys came out of the fiery furnace, you know what King Nebuchadnezzar said? He said, there is no God that delivers like their God. And from now on, we're all going to worship their God. And this is the guy who erected this massive idol to himself. And as an orchestra played, and every time he orchestra played, people just bow down and worship this image of him. And because they were faithful and aligned to the will of God, God did something that's beyond what they can imagine. There are things that God wants to do in you and through you that are beyond what you can imagine if you're stay committed to His will and His plan for your life. Amen? And as you pray that way, I'm telling you what, you're going to rise up on eagle's wings. You're going to find supernatural things that you did not know was there. And God is going to send people. He might send an angel, but He did to Jesus. He might send a ministering spirit to you. He'll definitely comfort you with the Holy Spirit and lift you up. But God will send people into your life to encourage you and to lift you up. There's so many times where I just randomly reached out and called with you. Hey, I'm thinking of you today, Mr. Church member. I'm thinking of you, and I'm praying for you. And I know you're praying. I just want to lift you up today. And I'm telling you, I've experienced that too. Random messages. Hey, just thinking of you, praying for you, and lift you up. That means so much, doesn't it? So God will give us supernatural strength. So I hope that you've already prayed that prayer of forgiveness. If you had, you can come to the altar. We can pray together. You can pray for your own forgiveness or pray to forgive somebody else. But I know we could just say, we could say a benediction, we could say grace, we could say peace, fellowship. But I have to be obedient to the Holy Spirit for just a moment. My heart goes up to people who are hard pressed. I can't leave here without giving an opportunity to pray for those who feel like they are hard pressed. Like you feel like your head's in a vice. Like you feel like you're in that place of frustration and just being overwhelmed. I have to be obedient and say, let me pray for you in person, online, wherever you are. I want to pray for you. I can't just do that. Because I don't know what you feel like. I don't know what you're going through, but I know what I have gone through. I know what I have felt like. I felt like checking out. I felt like taking my bag and going 1,000 miles in any direction away. And instead, I had to say, well, God, I really can't do that. Not my will, but thy will be done. And I'm telling you, my heart goes out to you because I've been there. I know the agony of your soul. I know the anguish. I understand the fear that comes in. I understand the hurt and the pain that comes in. I don't want to experience this again. I get all of that. And maybe my descriptions are just completely shallow and lacking for what you're going through. And I apologize that I can't empathize better without knowing. But here's what I do know. We can pray together today. And we can pray, Lord, whether it's a den full of lions, a fiery furnace turned up, whether it's a pit or a prison, metaphors all obviously, whatever it is that you're facing, we can pray. We can pray, God, you can change that. But God, if you don't change that, we're going to still serve you. God, if you don't change that, we're still going to serve you. God, we're going to stay aligned with your will. So God, help me. And help my friends that I pray with today to stay aligned with your will, to live your will out in their lives. And as we pray, I want to do this for those of you that are feeling hard-pressed and just overwhelmed and exhausted. I'm going to pray that you receive a supernatural strengthening. So that you're, when we go to each family for a minute, you're just kind of floating around like this. You're just like, you go, you want you to come to me like this. You know? And I want you to walk out of here just light-footed. I want you to walk out of here just, my shoulders feel light. I don't have that headache anymore. I don't have that knot in my stomach. I'm eating and enjoying my, and I'm just having a good time. And I just thank God. And then you walk out of here, you feel invigorated, strengthened, and like there's something supernatural on the inside. You can't even describe it words. But come on, you know that God touched you. Amen? So, I don't know who I'm talking to. I don't know who needs this prayer. I present the tickets to people that aren't out here that I will be praying for. But if if you're here and in person, you need it, I want you to come right now and we will pray together. And I guarantee you, listen up, I guarantee you that God will honor your prayer because of His will, and He will supernaturally strengthen you in Jesus' name. And your big picture for your life will become in focus, and it will begin to develop in your life.